to you by Penguin.
I, Mona Lisa, by Natasha Solomons, read by Amelia Donkor. Gallery Guide, Renaissance Room. Mona Lisa, Leonardo da Vinci's most famous painting. Leonardo da Vinci, Florentine inventor, polymath, and painter of genius. Salai, Leonardo's chief assistant at the Bottega and also his lover. Francesco Melzi, also known as Cecco, another of Leonardo's assistants, latterly his amanuensis, editor, and collator of his manuscripts and Salai's bitter rival. Lisa del Giocondo, a renowned Florentine beauty and the model for the Mona Lisa. Francesco del Giocondo, a wealthy silk merchant and Lisa's husband. Niccolò Machiavelli, a politician, operator, and occasional friend of Leonardo's. Raphael Santi, a young painter from Urbino and a confidant and admirer of Leonardo. Michelangelo Buonarroti, sculptor, painter, grouch, and adversary of Leonardo. Leda, queen of Sparta and Leonardo's most magnificent and beautiful painting. Friend of Mona's. Il Magnifico, or Giuliano de' Medici, of the legendary Medici family of Florence, powerful patron of Leonardo in Rome. Pope Leo X, brother of Giuliano, passionate about food and music as well as God. King Francis I, teenage king of France, latterly patron of Leonardo da Vinci in France, and the purchaser of Mona Lisa, Leda, and other paintings. La Cremona, the most famous courtesan in Milan, also a poet and the model for Leda. French galleries, Room of the Sun King. Louis XIV, the Sun King, admirer of Mona Lisa, Leda, absolute monarch of France. Queen Marie Therese, his pious Spanish queen. Madame de Montespan, Louis's official mistress and the mother of at least six of his children. Françoise, Madame de Maintenon, the royal governess and latterly the mistress who succeeded Madame de Montespan. Revolutionary France. Louis XVI, King of France. Marie Antoinette, his extravagant wife, a woman of great passion and style. Citizen Fragonard, exuberant Rococo painter, beloved of Marie Antoinette, who fell out of favor after the revolution. 20th Century Room. Pablo Picasso, painter and friend of Mona Lisa. Sigmund Freud, psychoanalyst and art lover. Vincenzo Perugia, thief and kidnapper of the Mona Lisa, Italian nationalist. Jacques Jaujard, brilliant chief curator of the Louvre during World War II, never seen without a cigarette. Jeanne, agent Mozart, French resistant agent, film star and Jaujard's lover. Prologue, Louvre, Paris today. In the beginning, I listened in darkness. When I was new, I had no eyes and could not tell night from day. But I discovered that I liked the music, the brisk joy of the lira de braccio and the flute, and the raucous studio chatter, the tickle of the charcoal, the steady warmth of his fingertips, all nudging me into life, layer upon layer. I came into being, not all at once, but like the build-up of smoke in a room, one wisp at a time. His breath against my cheek as his brush blew life into me. I swam into consciousness as if from the bottom of the deepest ocean, cool and black. I was aware of voices, like the grinding of the rocks against the waves. But I was always listening for his voice. He whispered to me. He willed me into being, coaxed me out of the poplar wood. Until then, I was content in the dark. I did not yet know there was light. My face came first, edging into view against the spinning layers of white lead. He conjured me forth with tonal shadows and blocks of shading in dark washes. I was coated again and again with a layer of imprimatur, translucent as a butterfly's wing. My skin was ghostly, not pink flesh, so he added a small portion of red lake and yellow and shaded me with burnt umber. My hands and dress and veil and hair were nothing but thoughts in charcoal, waiting to be. There were the first ink lines of the cartoon, the sharp point of the needle picked out my new contours, ready for the charcoal spolvery. His fingers massaged in the rubbing powder through the tiny holes in the paper. I was an outline, a mirror image upon wood, a collection of parts, chin, breasts, finger, nose, and with my new eyes I looked about me. The busyness of the day and the stillness of the night, I marvelled at it all. The stars flickered beyond the window, lit like the studio candles. Perhaps a celestial painter laboured, the Leonardo of the heavens, on a new constellation commissioned by the gods. While Leonardo was painting me, giving me shoulders and lips, and creating the cascades of my hair and the translucence of my veil, he talked to me. Painting is superior to music as it does not perish immediately after its creation. This song on the lute, although sweet, has already vanished, and yet here you are. I listened in rapture to these intimacies as something began to stir deep within me. The first seeds of love. At first, I used to gaze at Leonardo rapt and silent. Then one day he confided to me the secrets of the heavens, saying, "People believe there is a man on the moon, but there are only seas. Its surface is awash with salt water." I heard a voice speaking the question I wanted to ask. "There is truly no man on the moon," said the voice. Then, to my astonishment, I understood that this was my voice. I could speak. I did not know. Leonardo stared back at me, astounded. He leaned forward until his eye was level with mine, stroked my lip with his brush. "Are you really there?" he asked me. "Yes, I am," I answered. "Who are you?" he asked, studying me in wonder. I looked back at him and replied, "I am yours." My Leonardo was many things, imaginativa, generous, fastidious, but he was not fast and, in the time it took to conjure me, he confided in me a great many more things. He conceived new worlds in a single leaf. There was only ever one Leonardo. And there was only one painting like me. The other pictures could be looked at, but none of them could see. When I was young, and my paint fresh and my varnish uncracked, I was a revelation in white lead and imprimatur. No one painted in the same way after me, or no one who was any good. The lacklustre, soft-cocked, grey souls went on for half a century producing whey-faced Madonnas by the yard for altar panels in provincial churches. But after looking upon me, even the poets returned to the world with a sharpened tongue. Please understand that I am not the pretty bourgeois wife of a silk merchant. I am not Lisa del Giocondo. I can hear her now as she was then, her voice petulant and anxious, the rattle of her worries. "The studio is stifling. Can the window not be opened? Lisa, Lisa, her name is like a hiss of steam. Did I have to begin with her? To be made in the image of someone so ordinary." But as the brilliant lapis lazuli resplendent on 1,000 Madonna's robes are mined from limestone, so was I cajoled from the unyielding and reluctant Lisa. For a short while, like mother and a fetus, she and I shared a soul. Then I was not yet myself. The soft curl of Lisa's hair, rubbed out, drawn anew, the first curve of her cheek, the shape of her skull. Leonardo's thought and his intention. I was more Lisa and Leonardo than myself, but little by little, stroke by stroke, I became my soul my own. I looked about me with my own curiosity. I saw the lemon trees glistening in their pots lining the loggia, the dust on their leaves, perspiring musicians playing to keep Lisa smiling, to make me smile.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.